Welcome back to The Secret Life of Numbers, the podcast where we dissect everyday numbers and statistics to find the stories behind them. Welcome back to The Secret Life of Numbers, the podcast where we dissect everyday numbers and statistics to find the stories behind them. If this is the first time you're listening to us, we have 10 episodes that we've released in our first season that we encourage you all to check out. For those who have already listened to those episodes, though, this is a very, very exciting little bonus where we answer some of our listener questions about
season one that we received while it was airing.
And if you're joining us for the first time, my name's Lindsay. I'm our data translator.
And I'm Lavanya, the data scientist.
So this is kind of our interlude before season two is released in October.
What are some of the things that we're going to be talking about in season two, just to let our listeners know?
It's going to be a good season. We have a few more episodes that are a little themed to go along with the holiday season, whether that's Halloween or Christmas or whatever holiday you celebrate.
I guess we're also going to be talking about sleep and 8 hours of sleep.
Sustainability is,
yes.
We have two mini series coming up, which I think is going to be really fun. So I guess without further ado, what's our first listener question, Lev?
So our first listener question comes from episode one. And for those of you who know the lineup back to front, this was about, can hand sanitizer or can disinfectant products actually kill 99.9% of germs? The question here is, can you kill all germs? Like, what does killing a germ mean? And I believe we wanted to talk about the definition of life or the scientific definition of life and viruses here.
Yeah, so this is an interesting question because it kind of gets into semantics. Mm-hmm. Because in order to kill something, a prerequisite is for it to be alive. And the scientific consensus is that viruses aren't actually living organisms. To get into that, like, let's talk about what life is.
From a scientific perspective.
Yes, we're not getting into philosophy here. I'm a microbiologist, not a philosopher. But from Britannica, a scientific definition of life is that life comprises individuals, living beings assigned to groups, also known as taxa. And each individual is composed of one or more minimal living units called cells and is capable of transformation of carbon-based and other compounds, growth, and participation in reproductive acts. One of the things that is interesting about viruses is that they're what we call obligate intracellular parasites or organisms. Mm-hmm. So basically, viruses have to have some other living entity in order to reproduce and, you know, proliferate.
Yeah, and they can't reproduce on their own.
Yeah. So that kind of gets into the semantics of, like, most scientists don't consider viruses a living thing. But in the context of, like, can we kill 99.9% of germs, we throw viruses in there, I think, because they do cause disease. And that, within kind of the colloquial definition of germs, is what we're looking to kill. Mm. I guess maybe a more accurate term, and I'd be curious to hear your thoughts on this, Lev, would be, can we inactivate 99.9% of germs?
Well, yes, probably that would be a bit more accurate, but it won't have that, like, punchiness of killing them.
Yeah, because one of the things is, like, once they're inactivated, like, you don't have to worry about them as much.
Yeah, because what I guess happens with some of these disinfectant products is that they break down the proteins in a virus, for example, and make it incapable of infecting a cell.
Yeah, and that's what we're looking for. So can we break down all germs? Well, there's a lot of germs in the world.
Yeah. And that's something we talked about as well. Like it would be really difficult to test all of the germs in the world to see if you could actually kill 99.9% of all of them.
And I guess our second question comes from episode 2, which was all about SPF 30, or just the numbers of SPF and sunscreen.
Yeah.
One of the things that was brought up in that episode was that the perfect application, according to ISO testing standards, is 2 milligrams per centimeter squared.
Of your skin.
Yes.
So 2 milligrams of sunscreen for every centimeter squared of your skin.
So, Lev, I don't know about you, but I don't actually measure my sunscreen when I apply it. So how do we ballpark and, like, feel good that we're getting close to that perfect standard of application?
Yeah. So I did do a bit of research, and I came across a method called the rule of nines. So with this rule, the body's surface area is divided into 11 areas. And each area represents 9% of the total. And then sunscreen can be applied to each of these areas at a dose of 2 milligrams per centimeter squared if 2 strips of sunscreen are squeezed out onto both the index and middle fingers from the palm to the fingertips. Those 2 fingers of sunscreen being applied to each of these 11 areas will give you that 2 milligrams per centimeter squared coverage, or an approximation of it.
Oh my goodness.
All right, I'll tell you what they are. Rapid fire. So, number 1, head, neck, and face. Number 2, left arm. Number 3, right arm. Number 4, upper back. Number 5, lower back. Number 6, upper front torso. Number 7, lower front torso. Number 8, left upper leg and thigh. Number 9, right upper leg and thigh. Number 10, left lower leg and foot. And number 11, right lower leg and foot.
So this makes me think that we're going to be going through sunscreen a lot quicker or more quickly than we did before we did this episode, because I mean, I apply a lot of sunscreen because I have very fair skin, but I don't even know if I do this full rule of nines. Maybe I'll have to retool my routine.
Let me know if it helps you reduce your sunburn.
I had great success this year, not a single sunburn. That's always my goal going into warmer weather, is to have no sunburn.
Do you think that's because you applied sunscreen better, or because we weren't outside as much?
Okay, so there's a few confounding variables, because I wasn't outside a lot because of smoke, but I was outside quite a bit.
Yeah, smoke from the forest fires.
Oh, yeah. I don't just live somewhere that's naturally smoky all the time. Well, I kind of do. Only in fire season. But included in those, like, the past 3 summers, I worked outside for 2 of those summers all day in the heat of the day. So I have a good track record.
Yeah. All right.
So our next listener question is back from our compound interest episode, where we broke down an example of 3 different people saving money for retirement. One of the questions is, how much money did Alice have saved when Barney started saving?
Yes. Do you want to give us a quick overview of those three individuals again, and what their saving practices were?
Yeah. So Alice started saving when she was 18, and she put $5,000 away a year for 10 years. And then Barney started saving when he was 28.
Yes.
So the same year that Alice would have ended, because she stopped when she was 28, and he started with his $5,000 a year until he was retirement age. So he put away more money than Alice.
Yes. But in the end, Alice had more savings for her retirement because she started earlier.
Yeah. She had more compounding periods. So even though she didn't put in as much initial capital, she had like a larger sum at the very end.
Yeah. I did the math. And so after 10 years of Alice investing $5,000 a year and getting 7% interest, she had, if we're rounding up, $73,918.
Wow. So she, in 10 years, she had gained almost $24,000 in interest. That is unreal.
Yeah. $5,000 a year for 10 years is $50,000.
Hmm. So Alice came out ahead.
because the compounding, the time really helps you. All right. So our last question comes from our last episode of the season. And if you'll remember, this was about Tiger King. And the fact that more tigers are kept in captivity than in the wild. And so this question is, where is that big cat Bill that we talked about in that episode? Like, where is it now?
Yeah, so listeners will remember, especially if you saw Tiger King, that the Big Cat Public Safety Act was introduced by Carol Baskin and kind of to protect big cats, obviously. It's kind of in the name of the bill. And basically, Senator Richard Blumenthal, who's a Democrat from Connecticut, he introduced the Big Cat Public Safety Act last year, but it didn't make it to the floor for a vote. So Mr. Blumenthal said that he was hopeful that with Democrats in control and some Republicans already being supportive of the legislation, this is the year the bill will finally clear the Senate. So more to come on that bill, I suppose.
Yeah, stay tuned.
So thank you so much for listening to our Burning Questions episode. And we just want to put a call out to our listeners that if you leave us a 5-star review, especially on Apple Podcasts, with a question in your review, we just might answer it in our post-season 2 Burning Questions episode. So leave us a review, rate us, and we just might answer your question.
Yeah, you just might be featured. Thanks for listening, everyone. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, or wherever you find your podcasts. You can find the references we use for this episode in our show notes. A special thank you to Julian Bertino, who does our sound editing and music.
Have an idea of what number we should cover next? Want to learn more about what we talked about today? Follow us on Instagram at The Secret Life of Numbers.
We'll catch you next time on The Secret Life of Numbers, where the numbers can run,
but they can't hide. Thank you.